So in today's session, we will focus on what the modern periodic law is and what the modern periodic table is. This will be our focus. Very clear, very simple, two agenda items, modern periodic law and modern periodic table. I had sent you two videos yesterday, one about modern periodic law and modern periodic table. And they were longer than the usual videos that I send you because these are a little complicated and lengthy things. No other reason. So to understand modern periodic law, we will see, quickly see what we have learned so far. We have seen that from 19th century, early 19th century, different people have been trying to classify the elements. We studied about the German scientist Dobrynner, how he started with the basic concept of atomic mass and observed that if he made groups of three elements such that the atomic mass of the middle element was average of the atomic mass of the lightest and the heaviest element, then the three elements together shared some properties. We also understood that this law could not be applicable, could not be applied to all the elements that were known at that time, 30 odd. Then in the last class, we saw how another scientist after this German scientist Dobrynner, name being John Newlands in England, he observed and he also started the work with the basic concept of atomic mass. He observed that when that elements were arranged in the order of increasing order of atomic mass, the properties of the eighth element were similar to the properties of the first element. And that is why this law is called the law of octaves. We also saw that this law also was not foolproof. Mainly, it did not work after or for elements heavier than calcium. Structurally, I mean, by design, we saw that the table, the 7 × 8, 56 places table that Newlands created, it did not have enough space to accommodate all the elements that he knew then. Also, it did not have space to accommodate more elements that could have been, would have been discovered later. Then came another scientist, this time from Russia. I was pronouncing his name to be Mendeleev. In the video, you must have heard Mendeleev. I am really not sure whether to call him Mendeleev or Mendeleev. My understanding is when there are two E's, it is pronounced as E. And when there is one E, it is pronounced as E. So I pronounce this as Mendeleev. And Mendeleev did something different, something similar to what Dobrynner and Newlands did, but he did something different also. So he also started with the concept of atomic mass. Now, during his time, more than 60 elements were already discovered. So he arranged them in the increasing order of their atomic masses. But instead of following the atomic masses blindly, he ensured that he classified the elements based on their physical and chemical properties. Chemical properties mainly related to the hydrides and oxides, physical properties of melting point, boiling point, and density. Then he realized that just like Newland, he realized that the properties of elements were repeating after a constant period of time. The properties were repeating periodically. That is why his law is called as periodic law. The properties of elements are periodic function of their atomic masses. This is what we have studied till now. And we also studied that there were some advantages to Mendeleev's periodic law and Mendeleev's periodic table, and there were some disadvantages also. The advantages were mainly around he could predict the correct atomic masses of certain elements. He could he left spaces blank, which indicated that more elements would be discovered later on. And the disadvantages mainly were around isotopes and the atomic mass not being a whole number. We had cases where the same element has different atomic masses, and we also had cases where different elements have similar atomic masses. Also, another big problem was how to place hydrogen, because hydrogen, it behaved like sodium. Hydrogen also behaved like chlorine. Hydrogen behaved like alkali metals. You need to now be conversant with these new names, alkali metals. Hydrogen also behaved like halogens, chlorine, bromine, iodine, fluorine. This is what we have studied. So before we move forward and understand how to fix all these problems and how we can build on that, and this is how science works, you try to tell me in your own words, what was common in the works done by Dobrynner, Newlands, and Mendeleev? And what was different? I have already explained it to you. I want to hear it from you. You can come out of mute and speak. So let us understand this logic very, very clearly. Huh? All of them were working with the atomic mass, and all of them were trying to arrange the elements in increasing order. But the fundamental difference in how they worked was, while Dobrynner and Newlands observed the similarity in the properties after they had arranged the elements, Mendeleev arranged the elements based on, or Mendeleev classified the elements based on similar properties. And this difference is the reason why Mendeleev was successful much better, much more than Dobrynner and Newlands. Now, let us try understand how the problems that we saw in Mendeleev's law and Mendeleev's periodic table can be addressed, can be solved. So as things happen, as time progresses, more and more things are discovered. When things are discovered, human beings learn more and more things. If we don't learn, then our life is not useful enough. We should always learn. Every moment we should learn. So next came another scientist, another British scientist. His name was Moseley. He showed, and by this time, protons were discovered, neutrons were discovered. Moseley showed that atoms are not indivisible. Atoms were constituting, are made up of different particles, and one kind of particle are protons. Protons have positive charge, and that is what is the atomic number of the atom, atomic number of the element. All atoms have protons. I'm repeating it again. While there was another scientist who discovered that, yes, protons exist, there was another scientist who discovered electrons, another scientist who discovered neutrons and nucleus. What this scientist was able to understand and explain, that all the protons are together with the neutrons at the center of the atom in the nucleus. And that is what is the atomic number. All the atoms have protons. And as the very concept says, this is counting when we are saying number of protons. Number of protons cannot be between 1 and 2. Either it will be 0, or it will be 1, or it will be 2. It cannot be 1.5. It cannot be 2.5. Ya to hai, ya to nahi hai. So this atomic number is no longer a decimal number, unlike the atomic mass. Atomic number has to be a natural number. I'm not saying whole number, because any atom, every atom has to have at least one proton. This is observation. So it cannot be zero and it cannot be a decimal number. Now think how the simple change of from decimal number to natural number can help us classify the elements in much better way. So he thought, if we have this number and this number is such that there cannot be any decimal number, it can only be a natural number, why not arrange the atoms, arrange the elements by their atomic number? Why should we use atomic mass? Because using atomic mass is not helping. See how the mind is working. He's not saying that atomic mass is wrong. He's trying to fix the problems. If you remember, beta, atomic number is just protons, number of protons, whereas atomic mass is protons plus neutrons. So instead of taking atomic mass, which is a combination of protons and neutrons, and also it is decimal number because of isotopes and all, he looked at only protons. And life became easy. And the moment this change is done, the moment scientists started using atomic number instead of atomic mass, they arranged the elements in the increasing order of atomic number. And by this time, many more elements have been discovered. They used the method that Mendeleev used, that they did not follow blindly the atomic number. They followed the properties also. Anyway, the atomic number was clear. If one atomic number was 1, another was 5, they knew that there can be something with 2, 3, 4. We don't know yet. Jabardasti 5 ko 2 ke jagah pe rakhne ki zarurat hai hi nahi. So this gave rise to the new periodic law, which is called the modern periodic law, and it is still correct even in 2021, which reads, properties of elements are periodic function of their atomic numbers. So from Mendeleev to Moseley, the only change has been the word mass has become numbers. Now let us quickly see how this change from atomic mass to atomic number solved almost all the problems. Mass to number. This is very well explained in the, not explained, it's very well presented in the textbook. One of the problems in the Mendeleev's periodic table was with the place for cobalt and nickel. Remember, we discussed that cobalt and nickel both have an atomic mass something just more than 59. And we were not sure ki kisko kahan pe rakhe, kisko aage, kisko piche rakhe. But the moment we use atomic number, things become very clear, because scientists realized that the atomic number of cobalt is 27 and nickel is 28. Now, because the atomic number of cobalt is less than the atomic number of nickel, it was very clear that when we arrange them in the increasing order, cobalt will come before nickel. Now, the second problem with Mendeleev's periodic law and periodic table was the position for isotopes. In the textbook, the example that is given is that of chlorine, and Chand remembered yesterday that carbon also has isotopes of 12 and 14 atomic masses. Now, if we look at fluorine. Whenever you see something like this, what is there at the top is the atomic mass. What is the number at the bottom is the atomic number. So 37Cl17 means atom of chlorine with atomic number 17 and atomic mass 37. 35Cl17 is atom of chlorine with atomic number 17, atomic mass 35. These are isotopes. इसको कहां रखेंगे? कोई confusion है ही नहीं, because now everything depends on the atomic number. And both, whether it is chlorine 35 or it is chlorine 37, both have the same atomic number 17. तो दोनों एक ही जगह पे रहेगा, क्या problem? Because they have the same chemical properties. Another problem that I was explaining to Khadija, how many different elements can be between the known two elements? Example, suppose we take chromium with atomic mass 52 and manganese with atomic mass 55. कहां से बोल रहा हूं मैं ये सब? 52, 55. And how am I saying Cr is chromium? I just know. You will also know if you make friends with the elements. So the question that is being asked and we were not able to answer previously was, if we have chromium with atomic mass 52 and manganese with atomic mass 55, how many elements are between these two? How can be there? But using atomic number, it's very clear. We now know that the atomic number here is 24, the atomic number here is 25. And yes, you can write the numbers on the left hand side or you can write the numbers on the right hand side. But atomic number always is written as subscript and the atomic mass is always written as superscript. Now, if you look at the atomic number, 1 is 24, 1 is 25, uska matlab hai, beech mein aur kuch bhi nahi hoga, ho nahi sakta. Finally, the problem of hydrogen. Where should we keep hydrogen? Should we keep hydrogen with elements like sodium, potassium? In general, they are called alkali metals. They are metals. Or we should keep hydrogen with elements like fluorine, chlorine, bromine, which are called halogens. And these are non-metals. Now you tell me, do you think we still have a solution for this? If you remember, hydrogen is 1, 1. Its atomic number is 1. Its atomic mass is also 1. So nothing has changed for hydrogen. Absolutely nothing. So moving from atomic mass based model to atomic number based model is still not helping us to resolve the question of hydrogen. Should we keep it with alkali metals or should we keep it with halogens? We don't have the answer. But as I told you yesterday, because this is where everything starts, 1, 1, it is just put at the top left corner along with alkali metals. So when we apply this law, modern periodic law, and then we classify the elements, then the table that comes out is called the modern periodic table. Remember, something similar happened when Mendeleev was working. When he classified, he ended up with a table which was called the periodic table of Mendeleev, Mendeleev's periodic table. Now the law has changed, so the name has also changed. Now we are calling it modern periodic table. And this is the main part of our chapter. This is the basis. This gives us a guide to entire chemistry. If you understand this, studying chemistry will be so much easier. This is how it looks. Looks very scary. So much of information. If you have a textbook, keep it open. If you don't have a textbook, I will keep switching between the slides. Take a minute. Try to read as much as you can from the screen or from the pages of your textbook. Now, if you observed that table carefully, you would have noticed that there are some horizontal rows. Not just some, there are exactly 7 rows. Let us count again. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven. These 7 rows, mane ye pura, they are called periods. New name, period. And there are 2 additional rows at the bottom. They are not called periods. Again, if you observed carefully, the star here is the star here. The hash here is the hash here. Uska matlab hai, we wanted to write all these elements at one place, but it would have made it very bad, very ugly looking. So we have written it separately. Right? They are not new rows. They are part of the existing rows. So the number of rows are 7 and 7 only. 7 and 7 only. Chand is asking the element that is not written. So the 57th element is this, lanthanum. So lanthanum actually belongs here. Aur uske baad ye jo hai, cerium till LU. Unke liye wahan jagah nahi hai. So we have written it below. So one of the pre-class work question was, how many periods are there? So the straight answer, no confusion, is 7. You will not count the rows at the bottom. The top row at the bottom is the row of lanthanides, because the first element there is lanthanum. And the bottom row at the bottom is called the row of actinides, because the first element in that is actinium. The second thing to notice that along with horizontal rows, there were some columns, vertical columns. If you paid attention, you would have counted, and they are already numbered, that there are 18 vertical columns from 1 to 18. And they are not called columns, they are called groups. So whenever we will refer to the periodic table, rows we will call periods and columns we will call as groups. Let's go back and see if this is correct or not. Confirm for yourself. Find out where the group number is written. 1, 2, it continues. 17, 18. Once again, the columns that are here, these columns are not counted. 18. So if someone asks you, how many rows? 7. How many periods? 7. How many groups? 18. Without hesitation. Now, when we have these rows and columns, that is periods and groups, of course, when they intersect, wherever the rows and the columns intersect, just like coordinate geometry, we have boxes, we have places, we can also call them cells. How many cells are there? Again, if you noticed, there are exactly 118 cells. And you would have noticed that all the 118 cells are filled. Unlike in the time of Mendeleev, where some cells were empty, they are all filled. Let us go back and confirm. This is one box, two box, three, four, continues, and this is 118. No box is empty. Now an interesting question for you. You are sure now that there are 118 boxes and all of them are filled with one element. So we have listed all the 118 elements that we have found out. The question is, can there be more elements? And if there are more elements, do we have the space? Where? How? This is not something for you to answer right away. But appreciate that when Mendeleev was working, the knowledge was insufficient. People did not know about all the elements, so some cells were left vacant. Now, all the places are full. Does it mean that we have found all the elements? That is the basic question that I am asking. Think, we will discuss it sometime later in the chapter, not yet. So after periods, groups and boxes, the other structure that we have to note is called blocks. There are four blocks and their names are S, T, D and F. Let us go back and see. S block. So these two groups make the S block. T block. So group number 13 to 18. They make the P block. Group number 3 to 12, they make the D block. The actinides and lanthanides, they make the F block. These are the four blocks. Blocks are chunks, big pieces. So in this table, the smallest element, the smallest piece that you will find is one box. Some boxes on a horizontal line, they make a period. Boxes in a vertical line, they make a group. A group of boxes, a chunk of boxes, a part of the table is called a block. S, P, D, and F. Right? So we saw the blocks, S, P, D, and F. Now you might be thinking, why are we calling them S, P, D and F? Why don't we call it A, B, C, D? Why don't we call them P, Q, R, S? Or why don't we just call them 1, 2, 3, 4? There is a reason. There is a reason. And if we understand that reason, our today's session, this session will be successful, 100% successful. Let us see if we are able to do it. Moving on. One of the main features of this periodic table is it helps us identify and arrange elements of different types very, very, very clearly. If you remember, different types of elements are metals and non-metals. Maybe you have also heard about metalloid. If you guess, this is just a play of words. So if an element has some metallic properties and some non-metallic properties, then we will call it a metalloid. So in the modern periodic table, if you imagine a zigzag line like this, then the elements bordering this zigzag line, they are metalloids. The elements on the right-hand side, they are metals. No, they are non-metals. And the elements on the left-hand side of the zigzag line, they are metals. And of course, we have already agreed that we have placed hydrogen just out of convenience. अगर इस हाइड्रोजन को हमने यहां नहीं, अगर हमने यहां रखा होता तो सारे नॉन मेटल एक साथ होते. So just by arranging based on atomic number, we are also grouping the elements as metals, non-metals and metalloids. Now, what we saw now is the very, very basic structure of the periodic table. We realized that there are horizontal rows, we will call them periods. There are vertical columns, we will call them groups. Wherever they intersect, we have boxes, we can call them cells also. The elements are kept in each of the boxes. We understood that columns are grouped, the groups are grouped together into blocks, S, P, D, and F. But in addition to the periods, the groups, the blocks, there is a much, much deeper, much more fundamental concept that we need to understand that this periodic table is following, and it is not very clear in the first class, and that is, it is related to the electronic configuration. Electronic configuration of the atoms, electronic configuration of the elements. And that is what we are going to understand next. If we try to quickly remember what electronic configuration means, we studied last year and you had started studying it even before, that electronic configuration is the arrangement of electrons in the different shells of atoms. For example, when we say the atomic number of carbon is 6, it means the number of protons in the atoms of carbon is 6. All protons are positively charged. So 6 protons will give 6 positive charge to the atom. But we know that the atom is neutral. It is neutral because we have electrons also. And not just any random number of electrons. The number of electrons is exactly same as the number of protons. The charge of the electron, the value of the charge of the electron is exactly the same as protons. But while proton has a positive charge, electrons have negative charge. So 6 protons in an atom of carbon means plus 6 charge. It also means 6 electrons, that is minus 6 charge. So net, we have 0 charge. Where are the protons? The protons and neutrons are tightly packed in the nucleus. We are not going to understand how they are packed now. Maybe you will study it when you study nuclear physics. Right now, we are trying to understand electronic configuration, that is the arrangement of electrons. There are 6 electrons, but how are they arranged around the nucleus? And why are we studying it? Why do we need to know it? Because the electronic configuration tells us something starting with a V. Let us see if you remember, what is this V? Valency. The valency of the atom, the valency of the element actually depends on the arrangement of electrons, not just electrons. It depends on the arrangement of electrons. So if we know the arrangement of electrons, we will know valency. If we know valency, we will know how the atom or how the element will react. We will be able to predict its chemical properties. That is why we need to know the electronic configuration. So in this case, if you remember, we said carbon, atomic number 6, 6 electrons, they are arranged in 2 shells, 2, 4. So the latest model of the atom that we have, if you remember the name, it's the model proposed by Niels Bohr. Commonly, it is also called as the planetary model of atoms. It says that protons and neutrons are tightly packed at the center in nucleus, and electrons are revolving around it in specific orbits, in specific shells. Right? We are trying to use that model to understand how the periodic table is related to atomic number, electronic configuration. First thing, what is that atomic number? Atomic number, by definition, is the number of protons in an atom. Protons are positively charged, and we can safely assume that the charge is plus one. But we know that atoms are neutral. That means there is something to cancel out this positive charge. And that something is electrons, which were discovered by J.J. Thomson. And the only way the atom can be neutral is when the number of electrons and number of protons are same, because the charge on the electron is exactly minus one. That means we can say in a normal atom, the atomic number is not just the number of protons, it is also the number of electrons. So by definition, atomic number is the number of protons. But by logic, atomic number is also the number of electrons in an atom. The reason we don't define atomic number in using electrons is because of something else. This also we have studied last year, ions. There are some badmash electrons in the valence shell, outermost shell. Atoms keep losing and gaining electrons to form ions. So number of electrons can change. What doesn't change for the atom is the number of protons. So atomic number is defined based on protons. But as long as the atom is atom, it hasn't become an ion, the atomic number also refers to the number of electrons. And everything in this universe, you, I, the animals, the trees, the plants, and even the electrons, everyone wants stability, aram, no disturbance. And that is why the electrons are arranged in a specific way, not a random way. It's like, agar hum class mein koi seating arrangement nahi rakhenge, agar hum bolenge jo jaise aaya jaise waise baitho. So some people may like it, some may not like it. They don't know ki aaj kahan baithne ko jagah milegi. But if we have specific space, it will be all very orderly. So for stability, nature has designed it in a way that electrons are not there randomly, they are arranged in a specific way. Now, once we understand that the electrons are arranged in a specific way for stability, that specific way of arrangement of electrons is called electronic configuration. For stability. But while the goal is to attain stability, the consequences, because electrons are arranged in a specific way, again taking the example of carbon, atomic number 6, electronic configuration 2, 4, the number of electrons in the outermost shell is 4 only, it is not this. And this 4, which is the valency, determines the chemical properties of the atoms or the elements. So we can say in a way that the atomic number decides the chemical properties. Also, we are saying we are classifying the elements based on their properties. That means there has to be a connection between how electrons are arranged and how elements are arranged in the periodic table. How are they arranged? How are the electrons arranged around the nucleus? We said they are arranged in specific shells. And Tushar already pointed out that those shells are called K, L, M, N, O. I'm also telling you that there is something called as P, Q. Name. And they have been given specific numbers. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. No rocket science here. No confusion. And you would have already guessed that if this is the nucleus, the first shell may be K. The second shell may be L. The third shell may be M. Yes, your guess is correct. This K shell is also called as 1. The L shell is also called as 2. And the M shell is also called as 3. Alfia has made a very, unknowingly, Alfia has made a very important observation. She's saying there are 7 shells. 7, the number 7. Do you remember seeing this number 7 in this class earlier today? Number of shells, the number of shells 7, is exactly same as the number of periods that we have in the periodic table. Now you see the connection between the electronic configuration and the periodic table. We will understand why it is happening. So these are shells, but the structure is not this easy. And even this that I'm explaining to you, I'm simplifying it a lot. If later on, if you study quantum physics, then you will understand much better. And you will understand the reality. Right now, I'm simplifying it a lot. Yes, Khadija, the number of shells that are there, the maximum possible shells is 7. And the number of periods in the periodic table is also 7. Yes, correct. Now the complexity is not just shell. Each shell is divided into subshells. Now the subshells are also given some name. They are called S, P, D, and F. Remember, the shells are called K, L, M, N, O, P, Q. The subshells are called S, P, D, F. Also, notice the difference that the shells, the names of the shells are capital letters, whereas the names of the subshells are small letters, lowercase letters. Have you come across these names before? S, P, D, and F. So good. You remember that you have already seen these names, S, P, D, F, as names of the blocks in the periodic table. Now, someone can think that the names used in the periodic table are used in the subshells. But in reality, what has happened is the names of the subshells have been used to name the blocks of the periodic table. Just have patience. We will understand this today. Now, but before that, just like there is a limit to how many people can be there in a house. There is a limit to how many people can safely sleep in a room. Similarly, there is a limit to how many electrons can be there in a subshell. The S subshell can have only 2 electrons maximum. The P subshell can have 6. The D subshell can have 10. And the F subshell can have 14. I'm not going into how we arrived at this number. This is much beyond the current grade and also beyond my understanding also. I will not be able to explain, but what I can inform you is S subshell can contain maximum 2, P can contain 6, D can contain 10, and F can contain 14. Also remember that just like for the shells where we gave them a number, K was 1, L was 2, subshells are also given numbers, but in a slightly different way. Now, the numbering starts from 0. So, S is 0, P is 1, D is 2, F is 3. Now, when we combine the cells and subshell, we said the shells are K, L, M, N, O, P, Q. We said that the shells have subshells, S, P, D, F. So, which shell has which subshells? Now, if you study, once again, nuclear physics, if you study quantum physics, if you study chemistry, science in college, you will study this more. For now, if you can understand that the K shell with the number 1 will have only one subshell, S. L will have two subshells, S and P. M will have three subshells, S, P and D. N will have four subshells, S, P, D, F. And it is very easy to remember. This is the first shell, only one subshell. L is the second shell, so two subshells. M is the third shell, so three subshells. N is the fourth shell, so four subshells. So will there be five subshells for O? Yes, there can be. Will there be six subshells for P? Yes, there can be. Will there be seven subshells for Q? Yes, there can be. Now, when we combine this information with of shell and subshell with the maximum number of electrons that it can hold, we know that the S subshell can hold 2. So the maximum that can be there in the K shell is 2, because there is only one subshell there and 2. Whereas for L, it has a subshell S which can have 2 electrons. It has a subshell P, it can hold 6 electrons. So total, there can be 8 electrons in the shell L. Similarly, for the third shell M, we have S, P and D subshells. So 2, 6 and 10. 2 plus 6 is 8. 8 plus 10 is 18. Similarly, 2 plus 6 plus 10 plus 14. Mane 18 plus 14 is 32 in the fourth shell M. This mathematics is very clear. Now to make things much more easier, instead of using KLMN, we use the value 1, 2, 3, 4, and we combine it with the name or the value of the subshell and we call it 1S. Instead of calling KS, we call it 1S. Then 2S and 2P. Then 3S and 3P and 3D. Then 4S and 4P and 4D and 4S. That is how we name the subshells. Now that we know that there are so many shells and subshells, the question is, when the electron is there, where will it go and sit? जैसे हमारे घर में बहुत सारे कमरे, हम कहाँ जाकर बैठेंगे? That is determined by energy levels. And because we are trying to have stability, the electron will always go and sit in a subshell whose energy level is lower and usme jagah hai. For example, 1s ka energy level is 1. So first electron, when it comes, it will sit in 1s. When the second electron comes, it will not go randomly and sit in 5p. No. There is still one space here. So it will go sit in the same 1s. Then we will go to 2s, then 2p, and so on. But the funny part is, and pay attention here, if you see the energy levels, 1s is 1, 2s is 2, 3 is repeated. then we have 4, 5, and again it is reducing 4. Right? So the energy levels are not very, very orderly placed. So how are we finding this energy level? We are finding this energy level simply by adding the value of the shell and the value of the subshell. For example, when we say 1s, the shell is here, this one, the first number is the shell. So 1, the subshell is s. Remember, the value of s is 0, 1. The second subshell we saw was 2s. Now this is 2 plus 0 is 2. That is what we are doing. And these are not wrong. These are not wrong. When we look at 3D, 3 is 3. SPD 0, 1, 2, 5. What it means is, okay, chalo, I'm cleaning the screen now. What it means is, first 1s will fill, second 2s will fill, then 2p will fill, then 3s will fill, then 3p will fill. After that, it will not be the 3d that will be filled. It will be 4s that will be filled. Because its energy level is lower. There is more stability there. Once 4s is filled, then 3d will be filled. Then 4p. Then 5s. And this is how it goes. And this was explained by a scientist called Aufbaum. He said that the shells are filled based on their energy level. We calculate the energy level just by adding the shell number and the subshell number, and then we go on filling it by that energy level. So our 4s will be filled before 3d. Please understand this. Pay attention. Hydrogen, only one electron, so it goes and sits in 1s. Another electron comes. There is still some space in the s block, so it will go and sit here, 1s. There are two electrons. Now, when the third electron comes to form another atom, then 1s is full because it has already two electrons. Third electron will come, sit in 2s. Then the fourth electron will come, sit in 2s. Now 2s is full. After 2s, it will be 2p. P can have 6 electrons. So p, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then 3s, 3s, then 3p. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. After 3p, remember we said we have 4s, and yes, 4s. We will fill 4s, 4s, and then we will fill 3d. Remember, d can have 10, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Then 4p. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Then 5s. Then 4d. Is it 4d? No. Now we are going to something else. Oh yes, it is. It is 4d. Yes, it is 4d. 10 of 4d. Then after 4D, we have 5P. We will fill this, all 6. Then we start with 6S. Now this funny things come. Remember, we have 4F also, which has not been filled. And that is where we start filling F here, 4F. How many in F? 14. Let us see where the 14 are. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14. Then what is this LA? This is for 5D. Normally, यहाँ पे 5D होता, जो कि हमने यहाँ पे लिखा है, इसीलिए वो वहाँ पे लिखा. And this is how it goes. You would have observed that all the elements that are there in the S block, their valence electrons are in the S shell, S subshell. The outermost electrons are in the S subshell, whichever may be the main shell, the subshell is S. The elements that are in the P block, their valence electrons are in the P subshell, whichever shell it may be. Same goes with D, same goes with S. And now comes the million-dollar question. Is it the position of the H, that is hydrogen, which is problem, or it is the position of the helium, which is a problem? Okay. Now, if you see carefully, helium atomic number is 2. No? So the electronic configuration is 2. Where is this 2 coming from? All both the electrons are there in shell 1s. So it should ideally be placed in the S block, but it is not. It is placed in the P block. It is placed in the P block because we are keeping helium along with neon, argon, krypton, xenon, radon, and the other one. Because all these are the noble gases. Remember, Mendeleev also had space for this. He put them in zero group. There is space for it. There is space for helium. The reason it is put here is it is kept with other similar elements. And that is why we also say that stable configuration is 2 or 8. In the last, in the valence shell, if there are 2 electrons, if there are 8 electrons, it will be stable. Noble gases, inert gases. Because helium is an inert gas, it is kept with other inert gases. Strictly speaking, its valence electron is not in the P shell, it is in the S shell. So if you can think more about this, if we can there be more elements? Maybe yes. Ho sakta hai ki 7s, to 7s pahunche na, 8s. So if there are more elements, absolutely not a problem. We will add another row. The structure will remain same. The logic will remain same. Because all the atoms follow the same logic. The arrangement of electrons follow the same logic. What will happen if we put this F block elements here? Bas ye table aur choda ho jayega aur kuch nahi. We can do that also. Wo choda ho jayega. Just to keep it nice looking, it is kept outside. I just explained you this now, that S block contains elements in which the valence shell is the S shell subshell, P block, P subshell, D block, D subshell, and to find out which number, which I have already shown you on the screen. So if we are in first period, then the subshell will in the S block will be 1s period and S. To find the P wala thing, just take the period, take the shell and add P, you will get the subshell. But for D, you will have to subtract one. So if we are on a period, say 3, then the D will be 2D. Actually, this starts from 4, it will be 3D. Similarly, when we come to F, so So if the period is 5, it will be 4s. If I take you to the periodic table once again, I already told you this while showing it on the periodic table. This was 1s from the period 1. This is 2s from the period 2. Similarly, 3s, 4s, 5s, 6s, 7s. T block is also easy. It follows the same rule. So this is 2p, 3p, 4p, 5p, 6p, 7p. The problem is with the D block, not the problem. The thing that to note is this is 3D. This is 4D. Right? So this will be 5D. This is 4F. This is 5F. And this is 6D. That's all I wanted to tell you. We should be able to write the electronic configurations of the elements. Which elements? From hydrogen to calcium. We did it last year. Try doing it on your own. All I'm asking you to do is 3 columns. Column number 1, name of the element, hydrogen. If you want to write the symbol or make it 4 columns. Write hydrogen. Write the symbol, then write the atomic number, then write the electronic configuration 1, right? So similarly, when you come to sodium, it will be Na, this atomic number will be 11, and this will be 281. We did this last year. We saw that Newland's law of octaves, that worked only till calcium. It did not work after calcium. The simple answer is, reason is, after calcium, we see we have elements in which the valence electrons are in the D subshell. Yes. And this D subshell is a problem because this is 1s, this is 2s, this is 3s, this is 4s. So 4s we are filling and then we are going to 3D. Because of this, the properties change and the law of octaves does not work. This is the reason. The electronic configuration is the reason.